Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Henry Strozier, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Epochs of European Civilization, Part 2, Reformation to the 21st Century. Your professor is Geoffrey Hosking, Professor of Russian History in the School of Slavonic and East European Studies at University College London. After teaching himself Russian as a teenager, he has spent most of his life teaching and researching Russian history. He is the author of the best-selling History of the Soviet Union, winner of the Los Angeles Times Book Award for History, The Awakening of the Soviet Union, The First Socialist Society, and many other titles. For 10 years, he has taught a course intended to introduce students to the main themes, institutions, and ideas of European history. The period stretching from the Reformation to the 21st century proved a time of radical change for Europe, and with the continent's far-reaching influence, for the entire world as well. In terms of religion, day-to-day home and work life, and national identity, this epoch of European history abounds with fascinating events that include everything from violent revolution and conflict to breathtaking scientific discoveries. This course provides a greater understanding of the role played by such influential figures as Luther, Calvin, Napoleon, Stalin, and other key figures of the period. Further, the importance of the Enlightenment, the Industrial Revolution, the rise of the nation-state, world wars, and the Cold War is expounded upon in a lively analysis bound to shed new light not only on world history, but on the present state of the world and the future of global politics. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Epochs of European Civilization, Part 2, Reformation to the 21st Century. Lecture 1, The Reformation, Luther and Calvin. And now, Professor Hosking.
As we begin the second part of this course on epochs in European history, I hope you may perhaps have listened to the first part in which I covered the period from the ancient Israelites right through to the Renaissance. In the second part of the course, I'm going to begin by talking about the Protestant Reformation and the Catholic Reformation too, and then follow it up with the Scientific Revolution and the Enlightenment, enlightened absolutist regimes, and then on through the French Revolution, Napoleon, the Industrial Revolution, and the creation of nation-states to take us right through to the First and Second World Wars, and then the rebuilding of Europe after 1945. But at the beginning, I go right back to the period before the Reformation and start by looking at the Catholic Church as it was in the late Middle Ages. As we've seen earlier, during the Middle Ages, the Roman Church had not succeeded in establishing secular power in Europe, but it did turn itself into a vast and highly successful international business whose main commodity was the salvation of souls. It guaranteed believers' salvation through its authority, symbolized in the keys of St. Peter, and through the regular enactment of miracles. In the Eucharist, it was taught, the bread and wine actually turned into the body and blood of Jesus Christ. This was such a solemn matter that most parishioners only took communion once a year, and even then received only the bread, not the wine. In preparation for it, they would confess their sins to a priest, actually semi-publicly because the private confessional was introduced only in the 17th century. And then they would accept the imposition of some form of penance. These were minutely laid down in penitential handbooks issued by the church. Confession and penance were part of the church's attempt to maintain harmony in the community. That's exactly what they believed the secular authorities were incapable of doing. So they would not give absolution unless the believer reconciled himself with neighbours. In case of serious illness, the priest would administer extreme unction, the last confession, so that the believer was in a fit condition to face his maker. And then after death, in return for a legacy, parish priests or monks would say prayers on behalf of the deceased. Special chapels, known as chantries, would be endowed by the wealthy for this purpose. The church actually invented a new concept to enable it to extend its power into the afterlife. That was purgatory. This was a state of limbo, if you like, between heaven and hell. Most sinners would not go straight to heaven, but would endure purgatory for a number of years. The church claimed that it could ensure those years were increased or reduced according to the endowments given to it. During the Crusades, in fact, the church began to sell so-called indulgences, that is, promises that after death, the believer would have so many years, according to his payment, deducted from his allotted time in purgatory. By the early 16th century, there was a brisk trade in indulgences all over Europe because the Pope was rebuilding the Church of St. Peter in Rome and needed a lot of money. So in short, we may say that by the late Middle Ages, the Roman Church had turned itself into a skilful merchant in the goods of eternity. But there were countercurrents too. There were many in the late medieval church who criticised it as too worldly, too bureaucratic, or power mad. Christian belief was actually becoming more fervent. This was partly a result of the Black Death in the mid-14th century, which of course made people reflect much more closely on issues of life and death. And religion was becoming more personal too. People were developing their own individual faith. And if one looks at works of art of the late Middle Ages, there was renewed emphasis on the humanity of Christ. In earlier centuries, depictions of the crucifixion, for example, had often been quite solemn and static. Now they became much more dynamic, and they stressed the human suffering of Christ. Heretical beliefs were multiplying, and the church was very concerned by them, gave great energy to stamping them out. And there was greater public discontent, I would say, too, at the unworthiness of many priests. But in spite of all these discontents, nobody really rejected the fundamental notion that the church, for all its defects, was able to mediate between the individual believer and God, and thereby to assist his salvation. The first person to do so consistently and seriously was Martin Luther. He was a young and very conscientious Augustinian monk who had gradually come to doubt whether extra fasting or saying so many hundred Hail Marys would really save his soul. Initially, his complaint against the church was indulgences, which he believed were corrupt and which he claimed could not possibly have the power attributed to them. And that was the subject of the 95 theses he sent to the Archbishop of Mainz in 1517. And is said to have nailed to the door of the university church in Wittenberg. The Dominicans, who were the main sponsors of indulgences, reacted strongly, and their general, Cardinal Cajetan, was sent to interrogate Luther, to identify his heretical teachings, and command him to recant them. In the course of this confrontation and others which followed it, Luther became convinced that what was at issue was not merely indulgences, not merely temporary corruption, but the church's whole claim to be able to save souls. That, Luther came to believe, the church could not do. It was entirely a matter between the individual conscience and God. And the individual, in Luther's view, could receive all the guidance he needed by reading the scriptures. And here, of course, we come to a very important fact about this period, and that is printing, which had begun in the mid-15th century and by the early 16th century was becoming quite widespread in the main intellectual and theological centres of Europe. And that, of course, made it possible for an educated individual to receive the word of God direct. In a sense, he didn't need the mediation of a priest or of the church. Luther believed it was possible for all believers to become, in some sense, priests. He talked of the priesthood of all believers. He set out his views in three main writings. One was called To the Christian Nobility of the German Nation, in which he argued that the church had refused to correct its vicious and unsound practices, had drifted a long way from the scriptures and had refused to come back to them. And there was a nationalist element too in Luther's complaints. The Italian popes, Luther believed, were unresponsive to German grievances, so It was the duty of the secular power, the prince, to step in and carry out ecclesiastical reform. Then there was his book on the Babylonian captivity of the church. And here he argued in detail that many church practices had no justification in scripture. In fact, he reduced the seven sacraments to two, just baptism and Eucharist, for which there was clear authority in the New Testament. Attendance at Mass, he claimed, confession, penance, were all irrelevant to salvation, even damaging if they induced a false confidence. Against this, Luther upheld the right of the individual conscience guided by the Holy Scriptures. And then finally, on the freedom of a Christian, where he set forth the doctrine of justification by faith alone, to be confirmed and nourished by reading the Scriptures. Luther completely rejected the idea of intercession by priests, by the church, by saints, or by the Virgin Mary. Well, this was dreadful for the Catholic Church to hear, and in 1520, Luther was formally excommunicated by a papal bull, which he publicly burnt before one of the main gates in Wittenberg, before an audience of excited students. By this time, the emperor, the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V, had become concerned by the public support and notoriety Luther had aroused, and he summoned him to attend an imperial Reichstag at Worms in 1521. Luther's immediate ruler, Elector Frederick of Saxony, insisted on a safe conduct for him. Once he got to the Diet, Luther apologised for the vehemence of some of his statements, but he stood by their essential meaning. He could not, he said, go against his own conscience, which was guided by God, as he understood them through the Scriptures. "Here I stand," he said, "I can do no other." And he refused to recant, unless his opponents could demonstrate his errors to him by reference to the Scriptures. The Reichstag condemned him and was probably about to arrest him, but he was, quotes, kidnapped for his own safety by his ruler Elector Frederick, and then placed by him in honourable imprisonment in the Wartburg, that's a castle in the woods near the city of Eisenach. And here Luther carried out the formidable task of translating the entire Bible into German, which of course he considered essential if Germans were to live a proper religious life. The great majority, even of educated Germans, couldn't understand Latin. And so the Lower Saxon dialect, which Luther used for his translation, became, as a result of his work, the standard German literary language. By this time, Luther had quite a number of enthusiastic supporters. People were especially excitable because many of them thought the end of the world was approaching. The Ottoman Turks, Muslims, had recently moved up through the Balkans and had conquered most of Hungary. And people took this as a sign of God's wrath at the sins of the Catholic Church. It was, if you like, the approach of the Antichrist, which was the prelude to the Last Judgment. So people were very receptive, ready to take up new teachings, which suggested that they could reach salvation in different ways from those recommended by the Catholic Church. The parish of Wittenberg itself was reforming in line with Luther's teachings, and other German towns were beginning to do so as well. Some of them wanted to go even further than Luther. In the end, in practice, the new Lutheran churches kept many of the features of the Roman Church, including bishops, a central organisation, though they were headed by the secular ruler in the nation rather than by the Pope in Rome. Priests continued to receive special training and to be specially ordained, though now, as in the Orthodox churches of Eastern Europe, they were allowed to marry and have families. The main differences between the Lutheran and Roman churches were that the Lutheran Church kept only two sacraments out of the seven, that's say baptism and the Eucharist. It gave much more emphasis to preaching the word by means of sermons, usually based on a text taken from the Bible. And if you go into a Lutheran church, you'll see that the pulpit is usually quite large and conspicuous, placed in a central and prominent position in the church, which indicates how important it is. And then the Lutherans also emphasised greatly activity by the whole congregation rather than by the priest alone. It offered communion in both kinds, that is to say, bread and wine, to all believers. And also the congregation was invited to sing the psalms along with the choir, and hymns too. Luther himself wrote several dozen hymns to tunes from familiar chorale melodies. And this became perhaps one of the most popular features of the Lutheran Church, the hymn singing which everybody joined in together. Other reformers were more radical than Luther, notably Jean Calvin. Calvin began life as a lawyer, but later switched to classical studies and theology. His study of the Bible in the original languages convinced him, like Luther, that the Catholic Church was no longer truly scriptural in its practices. A new kind of church was needed. And Calvin attributed even greater importance than Luther to creating one on the right foundations. He put down his recommendations in his book, The Institutes of the Christian Religion, first published in 1536 and subsequently much revised. Calvin believed that the community of the faithful was essentially the parish congregation. And for him, the church as a whole was simply an association of such congregations. There was no apostolic succession, no hierarchy, no bishops or popes. Central church government was carried on by assemblies elected by the congregations and by their executive officers. Each congregation had ministers, or presbyters as they were called, to preach and provide pastoral care, all as specifically mentioned in the Acts of the Apostles, and they had deacons to assist them and elders to handle the secular affairs of the congregation, including moral discipline. All this was laid down in the New Testament. And Calvin actually established a church of this type in Geneva, closely allied to the city council, which, after something of a struggle, supported him. And Calvin's supporters set up similar congregations elsewhere in Europe, in Switzerland, in France, in parts of Germany, in Poland and Hungary. There were many places where the ideas of Calvin caught on. Calvin's church was even more stripped down than the Lutheran one. Enthusiastic followers of Calvin would actually go round churches removing crucifixes or even washing them, together with statues of the saints and the Virgin Mary, which they believed were idolatrous. If they didn't have time to do the job properly, they would gouge out the eyes of the statues and frescoes. If you go around some of the churches in East Anglia, in England, to the present day, you can still see the results of the Calvinists' destruction. There were a number of attempts to negotiate agreements between Lutheran and Calvinist churches to try and form a united body. The only one that nearly succeeded was at the Reichstag of Augsburg in 1530. The result was the Augsburg Confession, which was presented to the Emperor Charles V as the basis for talks with the Roman Church. But those talks broke down, there was no reunion with Rome, and the Augsburg Confession therefore remained simply as a kind of minimal agreed statement of Protestantism, as it became known, that is to say, the churches that protest against Rome. Ultimately, the Lutheran and Reformed churches remained distinct and unreconciled, the Reformed churches being the Calvinist ones. And of course, this greatly weakened their combined capacity to resist resurgent Catholicism. One important matter on which both Luther and Calvin were agreed was that they abolished monasteries. In their scheme of things, there was no place for the separate cultivation of holiness in segregated communities. Both of them held that ordinary believers should try and observe in the everyday world a standard of holiness previously thought appropriate for monks. This was what the sociologist Max Weber later called secular asceticism. And it's an important change in people's views of the world because it brings God, in one sense, closer to everyday life. He's no longer to be worshipped only on Sundays or only in churches and monasteries, but in the observation of the moral law, in family life, at work, and in everyday life. Well, why did the Protestant faith catch on in both its forms, despite the hostility of both Pope and Emperor? Firstly, I would say because it answered the spiritual aspirations of the newly literate, especially in the cities of countries like England, Germany, Switzerland, and the Netherlands. During the late Middle Ages, we've already seen something of this, many of those cities had experimented with new forms of self-government, and the Reformed faith, especially Calvinism, offered a religion which seemed to give spiritual justification for those experiments. Reformed church government by elected councils went easily along with city government on the same principles. And some communities actually appealed to the idea of the covenant, looking to the Old Testament and the ancient Israelites covenant, which I mentioned in the very first lecture of this series. That's what happened both in the Netherlands and in Scotland. Another reason why Protestantism caught on in many parts of Europe was that secular rulers had a direct interest in adopting its doctrine of church-state relations. And here I'm thinking not only of town councils, but actually of princes as well, and kings. Some of them had been attempting something similar during the Middle Ages. Think of what kings and princes could now do under the doctrine of the Protestant churches. They could expropriate church lands and property, including those of the monasteries, which of course they closed down, taking over all their income and property. Secular rulers could take over church taxes, the tithes, and turn them into royal taxes. They could transform ecclesiastical law courts into royal courts, regulating family matters, moral matters, which had previously been handled by the church. They could appoint senior churchmen themselves without any regard to the opinions of the Pope. And they could take over education and social welfare from the church. Admittedly, these matters involved extra expenditure, but on the other hand, schools, workhouses and so on could easily be manipulated in the interests of the state. In fact, with Protestantism, we see a decisive moment in the start of the expanding role of the modern state. So for these reasons, many German princes and cities adopted Lutheranism, along with the kings of Denmark and Sweden. In England, Henry VIII made himself head of the church without actually changing much of its doctrine, liturgy or administration, but his successors tried to do so, leaving a rather confused and changing situation which persisted in England right through to the late 17th century. In France, Poland and Hungary, the Protestant religion was adopted rather more ad hoc by priests, by nobles, by urban elites, according to circumstances. Local congregations, or conventicles as they were called, grew up under their protection, sometimes meeting in the back room of a nobleman's or merchant's house. In Poland, for a time, Protestants achieved a majority in the Sejm, the parliament, and gained an undertaking from the king that he would observe religious toleration. The Hungarian monarch, who, as we've seen, was under direct threat from the Ottomans, could not afford the luxury of alienating leading nobles by persecuting their religion. And so, in both Poland and Hungary, Protestantism, usually in its Calvinist form, flourished in the 16th and early 17th century. France is a complicated story, but for much of the 16th and 17th century, the Protestants, known as Huguenots, enjoyed a limited freedom to worship in their own way. When, though, they were thought to be challenging the royal power, they were ruthlessly cut down. In August 1572, on St. Bartholomew's Eve, Admiral Coligny, who favoured supporting the Dutch Protestants against Spain, was murdered, and at the same time, some 3,000 Huguenots were ambushed and killed in Paris alone, and more in the provinces. So probably tens of thousands of people lost their lives. This ruthless, large-scale violence shows the extent to which, in the 16th century, people were prepared to go to thwart the designs of a rival faith. On both sides, people believed that the salvation of all humanity was at stake, that if the opposite side came to power, then the Antichrist would follow and the destruction of the world and the last judgment. Well, all this shaking up of religious discipline meant that many movements took shape which didn't either remain within the carefully ordered thinking of Luther and Calvin or adhere to their compromise with existing forms of government. Calvin taught that only a few people had been preordained by God's grace for salvation, but his churches did not actually try to identify those fortunate few, so that the Calvinist church accepted anybody who was prepared to accept its basic beliefs. But some of the more radical movements of this time actually wanted a reformation of the godly, as they called it, in which the visible church would be the same as the invisible church. That is, they thought they could identify the elect, and they wanted only the elect in their congregations. They abandoned any claim to act for the whole of a given territorial community and explicitly accepted into membership only those people they deemed worthy for their belief and their moral behaviour. So what they were trying to set up was communities of saints. And they believed the most important visible sign of being saved was conversion. So that a dramatic, sudden conversion to belief in Christ, belief in God, was to them the most important thing. And they would usually mark this acceptance by adult baptism, or maybe rebaptism. But in any case, in their communities, they didn't baptize children because they didn't believe that the children had gone through any kind of conversion experience. And so that they were known as the Anabaptists, the people who didn't practice baptism, in spite of the fact that actually baptism was very important to them. They called themselves Baptists. So baptism was meant to symbolize a moment of rebirth, of conversion, the attainment of a new light. Some of these sectarian movements actually believed that those who had undergone it were now sinless and could act in whatever ways they thought proper because they were saved, whereas others merely believed that people after conversion had reached a turning point in their search for salvation but continued to need to abide by the normal practices of Christianity. And of course, many of these sects believed that the second coming of Christ and the end of the world were near, like many other people at the time, and so they were preparing themselves consciously for that. Some believed the best way to do it was to found communities of egalitarianism, poverty, and shared worldly goods. So in 1525, the town council of Mühlhausen in Thuringia, in Germany, was taken over by a fiery preacher of this kind, Thomas Münzer, who installed his own eternal council of saints in charge of the town. And they also preached in the surrounding countryside, where, as a result, peasants rose in rebellion against their earthly ruler. Their motley army was defeated by the Elector of Hesse at the Battle of Frankenhausen. And later on, these peasant rebels were specifically condemned by Luther, who was beginning to be horrified at the kind of religious activity his own rebellion against the Catholic Church had generated. Another group of Baptists installed a council of 12 elders in the city of Münster in 1534 and proceeded to expropriate the wealthy in the name of the poor. They also imposed polygamy, apparently in accordance with selected parts of the Old Testament. These were very determined people prepared to fight for their faith, but there were other more peaceful movements at the time. The Hutterites, for example, called after their founder Jakob Hutter, who renounced violence as a matter of principle. They believed that this was really the most important thing Christ had preached. And they established egalitarian and communal colonies in Moravia on the estates of noblemen who protected them in return for their high-quality work as craftsmen. And they practiced the mutual sharing of profits on equal principles when they took pay for their work. Rather similar were the Mennonites, called after Menno Simons, a priest from Frisia in the northern Netherlands. He settled in northern Germany, and they were tolerated, at least for a time, by the authorities, because they were peaceful, because they weren't attempting to convert people by force. Or again, there were the Swiss brethren in the southern Rhine Valley and Bavaria, who were persecuted actually by both Protestants and Catholics, and eventually died out. What all of these communities have in common is that they believe they alone possessed God's truth and were responsible for putting it into practice. One other community should be mentioned, and that was the Old Believers in Russia. In the mid-17th century, Patriarch Nikon tried to reform the Russian church in accordance with what he believed to be proper liturgical and scriptural traditions. Some of the changes he made sound fairly trivial. For example, he believed that when believers made the sign of the cross, they should use not two fingers, as had normally been the case, but three. And there were other minor changes in the liturgy which he proposed. And in Russia, some so-called old believers refused to accept these changes. They cast out priests who attempted to carry them through. They formed their own congregations with their own priests. They even shut themselves up in churches, and if the secular authorities came to try and arrest and imprison them, there were cases in which they set those churches afire and committed mass suicide. The old believers were very different, of course, from the Protestants that I've been talking about, in the sense that they were not introducing innovations, they were actually resisting innovations. But they're part of the same picture of a world which was possessed by the idea of either the second coming of Christ or the coming of the Antichrist and the Last Judgment, and who believed that it was necessary to prepare themselves in absolute spiritual purity for the greatest event in the history of the world. And that's what strikes one, really, about this period, is the number of people who were convinced that that was happening. Well, the Catholic Church had to respond to these upheavals too. And in the next lecture, I'll look at what the Catholic Church was trying to do in response to these changes.
This ends Lecture 1. Epochs of European Civilization, Part 2, Lecture 2. The Catholic Reformation and Confessionalization.
In my last lecture, I talked mainly about Protestantism in its various forms. In this lecture, I'm going to talk about the Catholics and their Reformation, which was partly a response to Protestantism, but partly I will argue something that would have happened anyway. And while I do that, I'm going to look at some of the ways in which Catholics and Protestants, even in spite of their opposition to one another, were actually working in parallel, doing similar things. Historians have differed over whether to call the Catholic changes the Counter-Reformation or simply the Catholic Reformation. Some regard it as a response to the Protestant challenge, while other historians would argue that it was an independent Reformation with its roots in changes underway already in the late Middle Ages. And as we shall see, the Catholic Reformation had many features in common with the Protestant Reformation, but also some irreducible differences. I would say that in both forms of Reformation, what we're dealing with is a new way of perceiving the relationship between individual and community and between individual and God. In the Middle Ages, most people were members of some kind of association, a guild, an estate, a manor. They had a position in a social hierarchy. They were led by a person, and so they were tied by links of personal feeling. Not always positive, sometimes negative. As for the relationship with God, that was mediated both by the association one lived in, the person one was led by, and by the church. By the late Middle Ages, it was becoming apparent that human beings, especially the educated, the urbanized, and the wealthy, were understanding themselves more and more in isolation as individuals, separate and distinctive from one another. They were becoming more rational in their perception of reality. They were beginning to exclude miracles from their worldview. And they felt themselves to be in a more direct relationship with God, and in fact with the secular ruler too, who was now becoming the sovereign state. Protestantism reinforced both of these tendencies, but also, in the long run, Catholicism did so too. There's still a major distinction, though. The Catholic Church continued to provide a solid framework of hierarchy, miracle, and discipline, which enabled the individual to order his or her spiritual life. The Protestant churches, by contrast, laid greater emphasis on the individual's own judgment, his capacity to search his own heart and to order his own life with the support of a self-governing congregation. The Catholic Church presented a picture of the universe in which God was still directly involved, intervening from time to time to produce miracles, in fact doing so each week during divine service in the Eucharist, where the body and blood of Christ was actually reproduced in the bread and wine. Protestants did not believe that divine power worked in that way. They held, rather, that it was revealed in the ordinary workings of the universe, which could be investigated and understood through science and mathematics, and once understood, were miraculous in a quite different sense from the way in which the term was used by Catholics. So the Protestants' worldview was rational and scientific, where the Catholic view was still rooted in hierarchy, mystery, and miracle. One can see these differences in the practice of confession and penance. In the Catholic Church, each believer was expected, before taking communion, to confess to a clergyman privately, in fact from the 17th century, in a specially secluded booth set aside for that purpose. The priest, having listened to the confession, would advise the believer how not to sin again, and would then prescribe a penance, fasting perhaps, or saying extra prayers. And the performance of that penance would purge the sin and reconcile the sinner to the church. So for Catholics, the road to salvation led through the church, and really through the church alone. In fact, a popular Catholic saying was, outside the church, there is no salvation. Protestants, on the contrary, believed that the faithful could and should improve themselves through prayer, through Bible study, through meditation, through serious conversation with a pastor or with family and friends. In other words, they should use their own resources and those of the world. They would find God in their own way. Or again, take the Eucharist. Catholics believed that when a properly ordained priest blessed the bread and wine, a miracle known as transubstantiation took place, and they actually turned into the body and blood of Christ, who was therefore physically present in Holy Communion. Protestants held a variety of complicated beliefs, which I won't try and go into, but none of them actually believed that a miracle was taking place. From their more rational viewpoint, they regarded any such assertion as arrant superstition. There were political equivalents to these differences. The Catholic Church was reshaping itself in the same way as the emerging absolute monarchies of Europe. The Pope was becoming something like an absolute monarch, and one could see this in the way he was rebuilding the city of Rome. While the Protestant approach to politics, and especially the Calvinist approach, was more like the self-governing city-states and later on the constitutional republics and monarchies of the late 18th to the 20th century. Well, let's look at reform in the Catholic Church in a bit more detail. It was driven forward by the Council of Trent. That was a great gathering of clergy, which took a long time to summon and was constantly being interrupted by wars and disorders. In fact, it stretched over 18 years, from 1545 to 1563, and hardly anybody lasted out the whole extent of it. It ended by anathematizing the teachings of Luther and Calvin and upholding the Catholic Church's doctrine that its authority rested on both scripture and tradition, and that salvation required both faith and the mediation of the church. So in both senses, Protestant teachings were repelled. On the other hand, the Catholic Church did abolish some of the abuses of which Luther had complained, notably indulgences. Most important of all, though, the Council of Trent set out to rebuild the church on proper foundations so that it could carry out its self-appointed functions more satisfactorily. At the centre of the reform was the role of the priest. Whereas Protestant churches brought their pastors and ministers closer to the people, notably by allowing them to marry and have families, the Catholic Church, if anything, increased the distance between priest and congregation. The priest was to be celibate, and the prohibition on concubines, which had already existed for centuries, was now more rigorously and successfully enforced. The priest was to be trained in a seminary, that's to say a seedbed or nursery, where he would study, at the very least, the scriptures, church history, Latin, and pastoral theology. He would, in doing his duty, continue to wear distinct vestments, and during the service he would prepare the Eucharist with his back to the congregation. He would conduct the service in Latin, which most of his flock did not understand or understood only by rote, and the exact form of the service and prayers were laid down for each Sunday of the year in the missal, a copy of which every church had to have. So in other words, what the church was doing was systematizing its liturgy and its services, making sure that exactly the same thing was going on in each parish church each Sunday. The only task the priest discharged in the vernacular during the service was preaching a sermon, and that he was now expected to do each week as a way of interpreting to the congregation the moral and spiritual requirements of the faith, how they should behave in their everyday lives if they wished to be good Christians. And he was expected to back up his teachings by running a Sunday school for children to instruct them in the elements of the faith. And for this purpose he would use the new catechism, a booklet consisting of questions and answers, on which children could be periodically examined to see that they were assimilating what they had been taught. What all this systematisation meant for ordinary believers was that they now had to abandon long-established semi-pagan practices which many of them cherished. For example, treating a particular grove or stream in their village as sacred, saying special prayers there at critical times like illness or childbirth. Villagers who claimed to have seen visions of the Virgin Mary or the crucified Christ would now be minutely questioned by church officials, and their stories were often dismissed as delusion or superstition. In the late 17th century, in Autun, by no means a backward part of France, peasants would annually sacrifice a heifer to the Virgin Mary to protect their flocks against the plague. And when a woman was pregnant, people would come to the chapel to pray before a cardboard Virgin Mary and then open her belly to see inside a little model of the baby Jesus. Well, in 1689, the vicar decided that this was intolerable. It wasn't anywhere laid down in the church's accepted practices, so he bound up the cardboard statue with iron so that it could no longer be opened. His ordinary parishioners, especially the women, were thus deprived of a symbol that comforted and reassured them. And this was fairly typical of what was going on both in the Protestant and the Catholic churches during the late 17th and 18th century. So the priest had very important functions in making sure that ordinary believers observed the church's own accepted traditions. The function of bishops was to ensure that throughout their diocese the priests could do their job properly. To that end, each bishop had to reside permanently in his diocese and make its care his major concern. That couldn't be taken for granted. One must remember that at this time bishops were often employed by monarchs and indeed by the Pope as administrators. The bishop had to make sure that in each diocese there was a seminary capable of teaching effectively, and he was expected to visit each parish periodically to make certain that the priest was coping well. So being a bishop was henceforth no longer to be a sinecure, as it had often been in the past. It was a job which exacted from him very serious functions, and he had to take them very seriously. At the very centre of the faith, the city of Rome itself, 16th century popes tried to make the city worthy of its status as the ultimate power in Europe. Pius V, for example, tried to cleanse it morally by banning bullfights, expelling prostitutes, and draping the nude statues in the museums. It must be said that it's not clear he was successful, actually, in his moral crusade. But he also made Rome into a great showpiece for the faith. In the course of the 16th century, some 50 new churches were built in the city, culminating in the great Basilica of St. Peter, topped off by what was then the largest dome in the world. The streets were widened and straightened, gardens and fountains laid out so that pilgrims to the holy city would find a worthy setting for their devotions, and also an expression of the authority and the grandeur of the church. Whereas some Protestants had banned images altogether, the Catholics made them more conspicuous and impressive. The new Baroque architecture opened out new vistas within buildings, while the painting and sculpture set out to dramatise the stories of the Bible and of the church's past. If you look at those statues, you can see flowing robes, passionate gestures, rapturous or agonised facial expressions. A good place, actually, to see this is in the work of Peter Paul Rubens in the churches of Antwerp, city of Antwerp, which was triumphantly re-Catholicised during the late 16th and early 17th century. Well, quite apart from the priest, the bishops, and the Pope, we have arising at this time new orders in the Catholic Church, orders of monks and brotherhoods to carry forward the work of the Reform. The most prominent new order was the Jesuits, the Society of Jesus, approved by the Pope in 1540. Ignatius Loyola, their founder, was a soldier, and his temperament was that of the medieval Catholic knight fighting a crusade against Islam on behalf of Spain and the Church. But he supplemented this crusading spirit with a care for personal spiritual development which was more characteristic of Protestants. Loyola's spiritual exercises show great psychological insight. They set out the temptations and difficulties the Christian soul can encounter and make recommendations how one should struggle against them. using the instruments of self-examination, prayer, meditation, fasting, confession, penance, and the sacraments of the Church. The Society of Jesus began as a group of young men meeting to pray and discuss the scriptures together. Eventually, they turned themselves into something like a medieval monastic order, but no longer living in a monastery. They took similar oaths to monks, but unlike them, they lived and worked in the world with the supreme aim of defending the Catholic Church, holding back and, where possible, reversing the tide of Protestantism. The Jesuits pledged absolute obedience to the Pope, and their structure was like the bureaucracy of an absolute monarch. It was centralized and hierarchical, with a head who held his position for life. Members of the order underwent an unusually long education, during which, in addition to what a priest was expected to learn, they had also to specialize to the highest level in some secular branch of learning or science, so as to make themselves useful in the world, and so as to be ready to adapt scientific advances for their own purposes. Typically, Jesuits would live together in a large house near the center of a city, where they would take their meals and worship. But all members of the order had to be mobile and adaptable, ready to go anywhere at any time and perform any service that their superiors should require. In the 17th and 18th century, Jesuits became a formidable and creative influence in the world. They set up many schools and even universities where they taught secular academic subjects to the highest level, whilst also endeavouring to train the minds and souls of the young for the faith. They set up charitable associations, which achieved a great deal in helping the sick and the poor. They sent missionaries to foreign countries, including China, Japan, and South America, where their Paraguayan plantations were, for their time, models of economic productivity and social welfare. In addition to that, several Jesuits served as personal confessors to monarchs and nobles, and therefore, in effect, as their advisers and people of considerable political influence. The Jesuits' enemies, and they were many, even inside the Catholic Church, accused them of Machiavellianism, that is, of being prepared to adopt any means, however morally dubious, to achieve their ends, to such an extent that in the end they corrupted the Church itself. There is no doubt that their influence on the religious, cultural, and even economic life of Europe was immense, and that they imported into the Catholic Church a spirit of organisation, efficiency, energy, and rationality that one might otherwise think of as being more typical of Protestants. Well, the Catholic Reformation was successful in a number of ways.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.